Good morning, church. So, question for you. Does anybody know John 3:16? I hope you know it. I hope you won't leave here today without knowing it. So, John 3:16 says, "For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have everlasting life." That one verse, if there's one verse you ought to learn, it's that one, because it's foundational to our faith. Come all you weary, come all you thirsty, come to the well that never runs dry. Drink of the water, come and thirst no more. Come all you sinners, come find his mercy. Come to the table, he will satisfy. Taste of his goodness, find what you're looking for. For God so loved the world that he gave us his one and only Son to save us. Whoever believes in him will live forever. Bring all your failures, bring your addictions, come lay them down at the foot of the cross. Jesus is waiting there with open arms. See his open arms. For God so loved the world that he gave us his one and only Son to save us. Whoever believes in him will live forever. The power of hell forever defeated. Now it is well. I'm walking in freedom. For God so loved, God so loved the world.
Praise God, from whom all blessings flow. Praise him for the wonders of his love.
Come lay them down at the foot of the cross. Jesus is waiting. God so loved the world. Amen. Amen. He is good.
Let me hear your words above all other voices, above all the distractions in this world. Let me hear your voices, above all the distractions. addictions in this world. For your words bring life, and your voice speaks promises. Lord, your love offers more than anything else in this world. Your words give us life that's never ending. Your words bring us love that never fails. Everything else will fade away, but what will remain are your words. Let us speak. Never ending. Your words bring us love that never fails. Everything else will fade away, but what will remain are your never ending. Your words bring us love that never fails. Everything else will fade away, but what will remain are your words. Everything else will fade away, but what will remain are your words.
Amen, church. Take a minute, turn around, walk across the room, say hello to your neighbors.
Check one. Good morning, church. If y'all could find your seat. Go ahead and have a seat. The Lord lives in the praises of his people, don't they? And that the socializing and the welcoming and everything like that, that's God's presence in us and in this room. So I thank the Lord for that. Next week, a great opportunity at Saturday at 6 o'clock can be had at Williams Wharf. I think everyone knows where Williams Wharf is out towards New Point. But we're having a No Greater Love Tour by Q24. But I will guarantee that you will recognize some faces in the bands that you see there that night. And I believe you'll see faces in the crowd that you recognize. So we have a food truck there. We also have compliments of the Meals on Wheels lady. We have homemade ice cream and cake that is free. The best four-letter word that you know, free. But it does come along with a donation towards the Meals on the Wheels program. So everything given that night will go right to the program that are being represented. So I encourage you to be out there. It's going to be a wonderful spirit-filled night, and we hope to see you guys. Friday night. Thank you, boss. So Friday night, in conjunction with that, we plan to meet there at 7 o'clock and have a prayer service over the area and just in general for the event. So if you can be there Friday night, it's a beautiful place just to be there. And just when you're praying and socializing and being with God, it's even better. So Friday at 7, prayer event. Saturday at 6, the big event. Thanks, guys.
Good morning. Good to see everybody this morning. Everybody awake? I'm still recovering from our family-style vacation Bible school yesterday. I don't know why. I didn't do much, but it wore me out. So. But we had a great time. Thank you so much for everybody involved in all that registration, food, the crafts, the games, the Bible study, setup, breakdown, and resetting. Oh, by the way, we were talking yesterday as we were setting up this room. I don't know if you knew this, but I'm going to tell you a secret that's very important. Okay, y'all ready? The closer you get to the front, the more comfortable the chairs are. That's intentional. So those in the back, hey, you know, just stay awake back there. But we've intentionally put these nice cushy chairs up here if you want to come sit up here. There's no metal framing to sit on or anything. But anyway, but it's good to see everybody. Let me mention a few things coming up. We say Q24, and then I don't have my notes before me. Or maybe I do. We have a business meeting right after the service, so if you're a church member, please stay for that. Sunday school will follow that. Hopefully the business meeting will not be very long. If you're a guest with us or if you're not a church member, you're welcome to sit in on the business meeting. It should be cordial, we're hoping, so I think it will be. Or you can go ahead and get some coffee and go on to your class where Sunday school will be, and it should not be real long, I don't think. Also, let me mention... we're going to have a Matthews Baptist Church orientation. It will be on September the 11th during Sunday school in here. Okay, it'll be just an hour, and it'll tell you a little bit about our church. If you wanted to know a little bit more about our church and who we're affiliated with, how things work here, and that kind of thing, it'll be on September the 11th, right after this service, right in here. Okay, I meant to let you know on that. I apologize for just letting you know now, but your class is maybe a little bit lower in attendance that day because we'll have that orientation. So, and I think that covers announcements. I wanted to do something this morning. The sermon's going to be a little heavier, okay? So I want to start off a little light at this point. What are some praises that you can share this morning? What do you praise God for this morning? Yes.
Family.
For family, okay? What else? Yeah, for a church, okay?
For health.
Health.
Youth group?
Our new granddaughter.
New granddaughter. Congratulations on that. So. What else? What do you praise God for this morning?
Sunday school.
Sunday school. All right.
Music.
Praise band.
Our pastor.
Our pastor.
Yes.
Thank you. You don't have to clap for that. So anything else? Oh, yeah. Our secretary, she keeps me straight, I tell you. Everything I need to know is found in that woman. I'm like, look, what do I know about this? She goes, let me tell you everything. You know. So, but anything else?
Our relationship with God.
A relationship with God, yeah. I wonder what people do, you know, without that relationship, especially when crisis come and hard times come. It's good to be able to lean on God and know that he's going to take care of us, lean on our Savior who saved us, you know, those that have put their trust in him, we will be with him eternally. So that's amazing. Let's pray together. Father, it's good to be in your house. It's good to be worshiping you this morning. Father, I thank you for my church family. I thank you that we can come together with the purpose of glorifying our Heavenly Father. Father, we come from all different backgrounds. We have all different gifts and talents, but we can come together united this day on one thing, and that is worshiping you, glorifying you. Father, I thank you that we can do that. Father, I thank you so much for your son and how much you love us and your son loves us, that he was willing to come and to pay for our sin so that we can know forgiveness, that we can, when we put our trust in him, know that we'll live eternally in his heavenly home. Father, I thank you for your great love for us. And Father, I pray that we'll model that love with each other here within the walls of this church, but Father, also throughout the community, that we'd be people of love, that people would see how much we love each other and how much we love others, and look to how we can meet needs and just help those around us, that you might be glorified. Father, again, I thank you that we can gather together and worship you. And we pray that as we worship you, that, Father, it's a joy to your ears to hear your children sing to you. And, Father, we know that through being in your presence today, as we worship and as we go through Bible study a little bit later, that we'll grow closer to you as we hear from your word and as we experience you as our Heavenly Father. In your precious Son's name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Church, please stand and sing with us. You know, when we come to faith, we are given the Holy Spirit. God lives inside of us. His power lives inside of us.
I can see the waters raging at my feet. I can feel the breath of those surrounding me. I can hear the sound of nations rising up. We will not be overtaken, we will not be overcome. I can walk down this dark and painful road. I can face every fear of the unknown. I can hear all God's children singing out. We will not be overtaken, we will not be overcome. The same power that rose Jesus from the grave, the same power that commands the dead to wake, lives in us, lives in us. The same power that moves mountains when he speaks, the same power that can calm a raging sea, lives in us, lives in us. He lives in us, lives in us.
We have hope that his promises are true. In his strength, there is nothing we can't do.
Yes, we know
there are greater things in store.
We will not be overtaken, we will not be overcome. The same power that rose Jesus from the grave, the same power that commands the dead to wake, lives in us, lives in us. The same power that moves mountains when he speaks, the same power that can calm a raging sea, lives in us, lives in us. He lives in us, lives in us. Greater is he that is living in me. He's conquered our enemy. Oh. lives in us, the same power that moves mountains when he speaks, the same power that can calm a raging sea, lives in us,
he lives in us,
he lives in us, lives in us, he lives in us, lives in us, he lives in us.
Y'all can have a seat.
Let me mention that next week we're going to have a special. We'll be kind of just lifting up our schools in prayer. So come and be a part of that during the service, and also in the second, the 11 o'clock service, we'll have a special emphasis on that. And I think it's so important to lift up our teachers, and we have so many teachers within our congregation and our schools and our students, and also we'll have a special emphasis on that. All right, so there's a show that came out, a movie that came out recently. And I think back to the earlier version of that called West Side Story. And West Side Story is based on Romeo and Juliet, if you're not aware of it. This is a spoiler alert. You might have to hold your ears if you don't want to know what's going on. But just as in the story of Romeo and Juliet, who are born to rival families, Tony and Maria are associated with rival gangs. Tony is a Jet, a gang of American-born youth, led by his best friend, Riff. And, Maria's brother, Bernardo, is the leader of the Sharks, a gang of first-generation Puerto Rican immigrants. And the Jets challenge the Sharks to this rumble to resolve a territorial dispute. And once and for all, they want to solve this thing. And so, at a dance or whatever, Tony meets Maria, and they instantly fall in love. Don't you love those stories where they fall in love? Of course, this is a tragedy, so it doesn't end well. So I'm sorry, that's a spoiler alert, too. But anyway, when they find out about this rumble, Maria sends Tony to try to stop the fight. And if you've seen the movie, you remember that at that rumble, Bernardo stabs Riff. And Riff dies, and Tony, to avenge Riff's death, ends up killing Bernardo. And it gets back to Maria. And then I'm having a hard time putting the story together this morning. I apologize. But later, Maria and Tony decide that they still have a love for each other, and they're going to get together, and they're going to run away or elope or that kind of thing. But something happens in between them being able to get together, and Anita, who's Bernardo's girlfriend, tells Tony in a roundabout way that Maria is dead. So Tony goes out into the streets looking for the gang, saying, "You can come get me, Sharks. You know, you can get me now." But then he sees that Maria is alive. And this is the tragedy of it all. Just as he goes to hug her, he's shot by one of the Sharks. And then the last scene, Maria's holding Tony in her arms as he passes away. Isn't that sad? And I don't know why, but I was just thinking about violence recently, and I thought this was a good example of how violence upon violence just solves nothing. And it seems to me that we're living in a violent society nowadays. Does it feel like it to you? And my kids would say, "Dad, you're reading too much news." And I don't know, for whatever reason, I read a lot of news and different sources and all, but it's depressing. It's depressing all the violence that seems to be out in the world, and that our way of solving things seems to be through violence. I mean, we just see that whenever there's some kind of problem, instead of just protesting, riots break out. When someone is upset about something, instead of arguing, they attack the person. And we just see so much violence going on. And there's a time at which Jesus really shares this kind of thought that violence begets violence. And as our nation, as we see things just seem to unwind, that seems to be what's going on in our nation today. And so I want to look at this passage and just bring in some other scriptures to just help us look at violence this morning. You remember that Jesus, the night he was betrayed, they had communion together, which we celebrate every Sunday, the first Sunday of the month. But then they went out to the Garden of Gethsemane to pray. And it says in Matthew 26, verse 36, it says, "Then Jesus came with them to the place called Gethsemane and said to his disciples, 'Sit here while I go and pray over there.'" And you remember, Jesus goes and prays and really goes and prays three times. And each time he comes back, he finds his disciples sleeping. And it's kind of, in a way, you know, Jesus knows what's going to happen. The disciples don't know what's going to happen. But he's let down that his friends weren't able to stay up and pray with him. His last time coming back is really where we see him. He's going to drop a phrase on us that really talks about this violence, begetting violence, okay? But let me read the passage here, verses 47 through 50 in Matthew 26. And it says, starting with verse 47, "And when he," Jesus, "was still speaking, behold, Judas, one of the 12, with a great multitude, with swords and clubs, came from the chief priests and elders of the people." I think that's interesting, that here they're coming to get Jesus, this peaceful man. And here we have this great multitude with swords, with clubs, the chief priests and the elders, they all come to get him. In verse 48, it says, "Now his betrayer had given them a sign, saying, 'Whomever I kiss, he is the one. Seize him.' Immediately he went up to Jesus and said, 'Greetings, Rabbi,' and kissed him." That's amazing, too, to betray someone with such an intimate thing. A kiss is how he betrayed him. But Jesus said to him in verse 50, "Friend, why have you come?" Then they came and laid hands on Jesus and took him. So this was a situation here that here they were in the garden, and he's praying, just praying for God's will to be done. And that's amazing to me also. There's so much to unpack in there that we don't have time to go through this morning. But here's Jesus praying and saying, "Lord, I don't want this violence that's going to come upon me as I'm, you know, murdered on a cross." But he said, "Not my will, but your will be done." And so as he's praying, then Judas comes up, betrays him with a kiss. There's all those here ready for some kind of fight. They think there's going to be a big fight. And maybe they thought that Jesus would lead a revolution at that time. There were those, Judas probably being one of them, that really wanted Jesus to lead a revolution, that thought that he would be this leader that would lead them in a way of getting out from under Rome. But that was not going to happen. In fact, Jesus would go peacefully. Judas kisses him on the cheek, and then it says the crowd grabbed Jesus. And let's see what happened next. In verse 51, it says, "And suddenly one of those who were with Jesus stretched out his hand, drew his sword, struck the servant of the high priest, and cut off his ear." So here we have one that's with Jesus. We know from the other gospels that it turns out to be Peter has a sword with him. I'm not sure why he had a sword with him, but he did have a sword with him. Maybe he thought something might be coming up. Jesus had shared that he would be arrested. But Peter grabs the sword and cuts off the ear. It says in John 18:10, "Then Simon Peter, having a sword, drew it and struck the high priest's servant and cut off his right ear." The servant's name was Malchus. See, Peter sought to defend Jesus, and could you blame him? Here, his best friend's being arrested, and he sought to defend him. Maybe he thought this would be the start of a revolution. They really did want the Messiah. They thought of the Messiah as this military leader that would help them get from under the rule of Rome, but this was not a military leader. This is a suffering servant that would be our Savior. The amazing thing to me also, though, that the next thing that happens doesn't really change the outcome, surprisingly, because Jesus would heal the ear of that servant. We find in Luke, the Gospel of Luke 22:51, but Jesus answered and said, "Permit even this." And he touched his ear and healed him. You would have thought that'd be the end of it right there. This miraculous thing that happened, and ears cut off, and then Jesus takes the ear and places it back on the man's head and heals it. But no, it's already in process. And then we read in verse 52. Jesus says to him, or to Peter, we know, "Put your sword in its place, for all who take the sword will perish by the sword." And this is a verse I want to focus on. This is a verse I want us to remember throughout this sermon this morning, is that all that take up the sword will perish by the sword, Jesus said. He said, it's not time for violence here. It's not a time for revenge or anything here. In the NIV version, it says it this way, "Put your sword back in its place," Jesus said to them, "for all who draw the sword will die by the sword." It led to a proverb that we often say, "He who lives by the sword dies by the sword." Jesus didn't say it exactly like that, but that's the concept. It also led to this phrase that was used in early in our history, "Violence begets violence." That's where that phrase first comes from. I mean, when we say that violence begets violence, it means that hate and hate begets hate. It means that violent behavior promotes other violent behavior in return. The phrase goes back to the 19th century and is based on this verse. And so Jesus says, you know, put away your sword. If you start taking up the sword, those that do that are going to perish by the sword. So I was thinking, what does the Bible say on violence? And let me say, it started early, violence happening, with the first family. It's hard to believe that the first family that God created, violence happened within their family. It was between two brothers. Remember Adam and Eve's sons, Cain and Abel. Cain was jealous of Abel because, for whatever reason, God accepted Abel's offering to him, but did not accept Cain's. And so Cain thought about this and became bitter and angry and revengeful. It says in Genesis 4:8, "Now Cain talked with Abel, his brother, and it came to pass when they were in the field that Cain rose up against Abel, his brother, and killed him." And this is a second generation of people in the world. And all of a sudden we have violence and murder. Brothers. It's hard to believe, and ever since then we've had violence and murder. In fact, it says in the scripture in Genesis 6, that the flood came because of the sin and violence in the world. In Genesis 6:11-12, it says, "The earth also was corrupt before God, and the earth was filled with violence. So God looked upon the earth, and indeed it was corrupt, for all the flesh had corrupted their way on the earth." And so he sent a flood to take care of that. The scripture actually says that the Lord hates violence. In Psalm 11:5, the Lord tests the righteous, but the wicked and the ones who love violence, his soul hates, it says. And there's a point at which in Romans that Paul writes about how God gives people over to violence if that's what they want to do, if that's what they want to follow, if they want to follow their own sin, if they want to follow violence, he'll allow them to do it. That's the freedom of choice that we have. It's a longer scripture, but listen to it, because I kind of think it describes the world, and really our nation at this point. In Romans 1:28-32, and it says, "Even as they did not like to retain God as in their knowledge, God gave them over to a debased mind, to do those things which are not fitting, being filled with all unrighteousness, sexual immorality, wickedness, covetousness, maliciousness, full of envy, murder, strife, deceit, evil-mindedness. They were whisperers, backbiters, haters of God, violent, proud, boasters, inventors of evil things, disobedient to parents, undiscerning, untrustworthy, unloving, unforgiving, unmerciful,
who knowing the righteous judgment of God, that those who practice such things are deserving of death, not only do the same, but also approve of those who practice them. It's a world that just is bent on sin and following that sin and following that violence. And it says here, do those things, but they approve of those and they celebrate those who go down those avenues. That really describes our nation, our world at this time. And so Jesus says that violence begets violence. Jesus says that violence leads to more violence. Again, it says, in verse 52, it says, but Jesus said to him, put your sword in its place, for all who take up the sword, all who take the sword will perish by the sword. Violence leads to violence. I mean, our knee-jerk reaction to respond is to respond in kind. If you hurt me, I will hurt you. Isn't that how we often feel? And isn't that how we often respond? You would think as Christ followers, we should be above that, but even Christ followers, we find them. I have a pastor friend that I absolutely love, but the other day he was so mad at a church member, he goes, I could just hit them in the face. Now, this is a private conversation between us. I won't tell you who that pastor is, and he's not local, okay? But I was like shocked when he said, you hit him in the face? I don't think we do that. I think you'd lose your job immediately and probably go to jail for that, you know? But even as Christ followers, it's hard for that. And really, before Christ came, that was the way things were done. It was easier, just, you know, eye for eye type of thing. It says in Exodus 21, 23 through 25, but if any harm follows, then you shall give life for life, eye for eye, tooth for tooth, hand for hand, foot for foot, burn for burn, wound for wound, stripe for stripe, violence for violence. I like what Gandhi said. Gandhi said, an eye for an eye will only make the whole world blind. Oh my goodness, is the world not blind? And are we not doing this eye for eye thing, it seems? And it seems here in the United States, we have gone back to that eye for eye type of thing. If a police officer is killed, people will riot and destroy property. If we don't like the results of an election, we'll riot and storm the Capitol building. If we don't like the outcome of a court case, we'll riot and destroy property and threaten judges. I mean, it just seems like the go-to way of solving problems nowadays seems to be violence. You know, so many are set on fighting for social justice. Pope John Paul II said this, social justice cannot be attained by violence. Violence kills what it intends to create. You know, it's a world where even an insult or something that frustrates us leads to people striking out and stabbing and shooting. I mean, there's some crazy things that have happened in this world. This is where my kids say I read too much. But, you know, there's this person upset about how hot their soup was, I think, and throws it in the manager's face. Do you remember that? Maybe I read some weird stuff. A worker was killed in Subway restaurant for putting too much mayonnaise on a sandwich. What is it? And let me tell you, I was in a Subway restaurant one time, and a person ordered something and did not order what they wanted. They said the wrong thing. And they took it out on this little girl that was a friend of my son's at the Subway restaurant. And so I defended her. And the next thing I knew, I was about to be beat up. And my kids will never forget that. They were so embarrassed. And I was scared to death. Luckily, didn't get violent, but I was worried about that. Why is it that we respond in that way so easy? A girl was shot in McDonald's for throwing water in an employee's face. Now, she shouldn't have thrown water in the employee's face, but does that justify being killed over it? A Wendy's worker killed a 67-year-old man who had a complaint by just punching him as hard as he could. Hard to believe. How about this? A man shot a female postal walker after she stopped delivering mail to his house because of his vicious dog. A man is cut off in traffic, so he pulls out a gun and shoots at a car, killing a toddler. This is a world we live in, a world that just seems to try to solve everything with violence. There's so many shootings. There's school shootings and workplace shootings and concert shootings and mall shootings and parade shootings and just random shootings for no reason. It's scary. It's really scary. And this is the world we live in. Proverbs 21:7 says, the violence of the wicked will destroy them. I think it'll destroy us along the way too, because we refuse to do justice. Martin Luther King Jr. said this, this is the ultimate weakness of violence. It multiplies evil and violence in the universe. It doesn't solve any problems. And it really doesn't. When we try to use violence to solve our problems, it doesn't solve problems. It just creates more violence. And I think that we see that's what's going on. You see one group of people respond in violence, and then the next group, next thing that happened, they think, well, we should respond in violence also. And it just keeps going over and over and over again. You know that I had a police officer friend that was shot basically for no reason and killed. And it hurts to see the world respond like that. Now, there are times for violence. And even in the scripture, God used violence at times and wars to bring about his will. But it's under his guidance that we look for that. There are times also that Jesus said we do take up the sword. I'll let you look those up later if you like. Matthew 10:34 and also Luke 22:36. There are times that Jesus calls for us to do this. But nowadays, we're just doing it just in response to everything. But how do we overcome violence? How do we overcome violence? How does a Christ follower do that? And Jesus tells us. And these are things that have been out of different sermons that we've had recently. You've heard these before. And yeah, on the one hand, they're shocking, but it's what we're called to do. Jesus says, first of all, turn the other cheek. That's what's going to make a Christ follower stand out from the rest of the world. This is from the Sermon on the Mount in Matthew 5:38-42. Jesus says this, you have heard that it is said, an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth. But I tell you, do not resist an evil person, but whoever slaps you on the right cheek, turn the other to him also. And if anyone wants to sue you and take away your tunic, let him have your cloak also. And whoever compels you to go 1 mile, go with him too. Give to him who asks you, and from him who wants to borrow from you, do not turn away. This is one that's serving others. That even though violence may come their way, they're not going to respond in violence. They will respond in kindness. Paul says that too. Paul says we can repay evil violence with good. Instead of responding in violence. And that might be the difference between those that follow Christ and the rest of the world is that when violence comes upon us or in our neighborhood or whatever it might be, instead of responding in violence, we respond in goodness. Romans 12:17-21, Paul writes this, repay no one evil for evil. Have regard for the good things in the sight of all men. If it is possible, as much as it depends on you, live peaceably with all men. That's a good statement. You know, if it's possible, as much as it depends on you, live peaceably with all men. Beloved, do not avenge yourselves, but rather give place to the wrath, for it is written, vengeance is mine. I will repay, says the Lord. It's up to God to revenge, if you will, his people. Verse 20, therefore, if your enemy is hungry, feed him. If he is thirsty, give him drink. And then I like this part. For in doing so, you heap coals of fire upon his head. That's just an analogy. It's saying, you know, use this way of responding instead of violence. And in your own mind, you can think of it a way of being violent towards them because they want you to respond in violence, probably. But you're responding in kindness. And that might even fire them up more. I would hope not. And then verse 21, do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with what? With good. That's what we should be doing in the world. You know, I think of years ago in that shooting in that Amish school and how the Amish responded in prayer and forgiveness. I mean, that's hard to do, you know. But that does set an example for what we as Christ followers should do. In fact, Jesus says, not only that, not only don't be violent, and like Paul, not only repay evil with goodness, he takes it a step further, and he says to love those that are violent, love those that are evil. Love those that are enemies to you. Yeah, we are challenged as Christ followers to be different from the world. And it is harder, but we don't do it in our own strength. Christ gives us the strength to do that. We should stand out from the rest of the world in the way we respond to what's going on around us. In Matthew 5, 43 through 44, Jesus says this. This is also from the Sermon on the Mount. You have heard that it was said, you shall love your neighbor and hate your enemy. But I say to you, love your enemies. Bless those who curse you. Do good to those who hate you. And pray for those who spitefully use you and persecute you. Jesus says, we are to love and to pray for and to take care of those who are enemies to us. He says in Luke 6, 27 through 28, but I say to you who hear, love your enemies, do good to those who hate you, bless those who curse you, and pray for those who spitefully use you. There it is again. This is how we respond in an age of violence, with love, with blessing, with prayer. Again, Martin Luther King Jr. said this, hate begets hate, violence begets violence, toughness begets a greater toughness. We must meet the force of hate with the power of love. Reminds me of an old song, a very old Christian song. Back in the 1960s, a Catholic priest wrote this song. It's been covered by such artists as Jars of Clay, Rebecca St. James, and For King and Country. And it's called They'll Know We Are Christians by Our Love. Do you remember that? We sang that in college. And it was old already in college, but I sang that. But that is true. They'll know that we are Christ followers by our love, not by the battles that we seek or hope to win or the battles that we wage. It's by our love. It's based on John 13, 35. By this, all will know that you are my disciples if you have love for one another. So in the midst of this violence and all that's going on in the world, we are called to love. It's not an easy thing. If it was, everybody would be doing it. But it's our calling. And we don't have to do it in our own power because we do it in the power of Christ. When you accept Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, His Holy Spirit lives in you. He'll guide you. He'll strengthen you. And you can do the impossible through His strength, not through your own strength. And yes, in our own strength, we cannot love our enemies, but in Christ's power, the one that went to the cross for each one of us, the one that said, forgive them, Lord. They don't know what they're doing. He gives us the power to love in the midst of a time where there's violence. So yeah, basically Jesus said, he who lives by the sword dies by the sword. But let's follow Paul's response. Do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good. Let's pray together. Father, it's good to be a follower of yours, to know you as our Heavenly Father, to know your Son who absolutely loves us. And Father, at the point where he could have started a war, Father, he chose to live peacefully and even go to the cross for each one of us. As he said to Peter, you know, put your sword away. Those that live by violence will die by violence. Father, we're in a world that just seems to respond to everything with violence. And Father, we just pray that in the midst of this, you'll guide us as your followers in how to respond. Father, how do we promote love? How do we love our enemies? How do we bless them and treat them well? Father, remind us to pray for them. And Father, help us as Christ followers to set the example for the rest of this world, the rest of our nation. That yes, we can have protests that aren't violent. Father, we can disagree without hating each other and hurting each other. And Father, we can find a way to even love each other in the midst of all this. Father, I think the way that this will happen as the nation is called back to you. And so, Father, I do pray that our leaders will look towards your word to guide them in the decisions that they make. And Father, I pray as citizens of this nation, we'll look towards your word and how to respond to those things that maybe we don't agree with, even those things that frustrate us. Instead of setting out in violence, Father, I pray that you'd guide us in your word to love and to be kind and to pray for all around us. Father, I lift up those here today. If there's anyone that has not accepted you as Lord and Savior, I pray at this time they'll take that opportunity to put their trust in you, to allow what your Son did on the cross for them, to pay for their sins, to allow that to happen in their life, that they can know your forgiveness, that they can live eternally with you. In your precious Son's name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Please stand and sing with us. Amazing love that welcomes me, the kindness of mercy that bought with blood, wholeheartedly, my soul undeserving. God, you're so good. God, you're so good. God, you're so good. You're so good to me.
Behold the cross, age to age, and hour by hour. The dead are raised, the sinner saved.
So good to me. I am. God, you're so good. God, you're so good. Oh God, you're so good. You're so good to me.
And all God's people said, amen. Just a reminder, we have a business meeting right now. If you're a church member, please stick around. If you're a visitor, please, you go get coffee first. You can have it. We'll get it later. Find your Sunday school room. Hang out there for a minute. We'll be quick.